Over the past couple of videos, we've been looking at a couple of Gang of Four patterns, the composite pattern and the visitor pattern, and now we're going to look at a third related pattern, a thing called the flyweight pattern. Once again, rather like the visitor pattern, although we can use this in collaboration with the composite pattern, and that's what I'm going to show you today, it is useful with all sorts of different data structures. When you've got a situation where you have the potential for a lot of duplicated data, the key idea behind the flyweight pattern is to save memory. So let's have a look at what we've got there. And we're going back to the composite pattern that I showed you, but I've made a few changes just to get things on a better footing for this. So if we look at our program, the main change that I've made here is rather than having those predefined work items and communication items and that sort of thing, I've actually created these directly in main. So there we've got a work item for design the GUI, there we've got a purchase item for buy coffee and that sort of thing. And also, rather than calling new directly there, I'm starting to create these through a factory. And that's going to be necessary when we see how this flyweight pattern works. But the thing that we have with our factory, it's pretty simple. We just ask for a work item or a communication item or a purchase item and pass in the data. But one thing I've put in here already, which is really just to demonstrate the benefits of this pattern, you wouldn't have it in real code, but I'm just keeping an object count of how many total objects we've created. And then at the end of all this, I just print that out. So if we run this, we can see it's doing all exactly the same thing it did before, but then we've got this total objects created of 11. So that was all of the different items. But the thing is, if we take a look at this, we might decide that just having coffee the once is not really how things are going to be. We're going to be buying coffee several times. So if I copy that, let's also have a cup of coffee before we buy our book, and let's have a cup of coffee before we call New York. And in fact, let's have another cup of coffee before we call New York there as well. So I've created four purchase items of buy a cup of coffee. And if we take a look at that, then we can see we've now got 14 items created and we've got a slightly different structure with all that coffee. But the thing about that is, you might think that is slightly wasteful because all of those coffee items are exactly the same. It's the same coffee, the same price, the same supplier. Might not be, of course, but in this case it happens to be. And so why do we need to duplicate that? And that's the key idea of the flyweight pattern. Is when you've got a structure like composite and you have shared data across nodes, you can save memory if you actually have shared nodes rather than just shared data. The thing to bear in mind about it is that's only going to work if these things are immutable. If it were possible to change, say, the price of a coffee, then if that were being shared across the structure, then you change it in one place, it changes it in another place, and that shouldn't happen. They should remain separate objects. So that's why these items have to be immutable. And as we saw in an earlier video, in C# 9, which I've got here, the neat way to create immutable objects is to have them as records. So that's actually another change I've made here. That if we look at each of our derived items, we have these as records. So there's our work item, there's our purchase item, there's our communication item, and nothing really different if you compare that to what we had before, except they're implemented as records, not as classes. My composite, however, still needs to be a class because the composite isn't going to be immutable. That's how we structure all these things. So the composite itself doesn't get really featured in this flyweight. And for that reason, we've also had to change the root item, the to-do item itself, to an interface, because you're not allowed to derive a class from a record or a record from a class. So we've got to have an interface there so that the leaf items can be records and the composite can be a class. So no real changes in behavior there as yet. It's just introducing these records. And the thing about records is they give us two features, actually. We get the fact that they are immutable. So once we've set up this purchase item, we can't change it. But also, it gives us an automatically overridden equals method so that we can compare these items on a value basis, not on a reference basis, but on a value basis, which is again what we want to do here because we're saying that those two coffees are duplicates because they have the same value, even though they're different things. So what do we do? Well, we go to our factory and we introduce in here what is known as a flyweight pool. So this is where we're going to store all of the objects that have been created so we can hand them out instead of duplicates. So we will have a private read-only, and I'm going to use a class called HashSet here, which is the ideal one for this purpose, which just allows us to store these things and look them up on the basis of that value equals. And so this is going to be a hash set of I to do items, and we call this the flyweight pool and just create it. And then for now, let's just start this with the purchase item because that's the one we've got duplicates of. So what I'm going to do here is actually I'm still going to create my purchase item. So we'll call this new item and then just pop into there that actual creation. But this is only going to be temporary if we've already got one of these. So we remember we're trying to save memory, so it's okay to have that for a short period of time. And then what we've got to do is see if there is already a matching item in our hash set. So what we can do for that is we say if and then underscore flyweight pool, and that has a method called try get value. So what that does is allows us to look up a value which matches new item. It's going to match it using this automatically generated value-based equals method that we get because it's a record. And then we're going to get out either the item that matches inside the hash set, or if there's nothing there, it'll just return false and give us back null. So we can say out var, and then let's have found item. And if it does find an item, so if try get value returns true, then we simply return that found item. In which case the new item will now not have been stored anywhere, it'll be up for garbage collection, we don't have to worry about it. Whereas if we haven't found it, then that means we're going to need to return the new item. We're going to obviously need to increment that object count because we've created a new item that we're going to use now. And also, we've got to add it to the flyweight pool so that next time it will get looked up correctly. And now if we do that, if we run that, we can see that although it's behaving the same way, we've still got all those coffees, it's now back down to 11 rather than the 14 because it's only created the one. We can just take a quick look in the debugger. So in here, first time we come in, we create a new item. It doesn't find it. So the new item that we created, we add to the pool, increase the count and return it. But next time around, we create the item, but then we discover we've already got one in there. So we return the one that we found. The new item will disappear when it gets garbage collected. And that's going to be the same on all of the subsequent ones, presuming it's the same item. Obviously, when we purchase something else like the server, that will not match up. But that's the basics of how it works. So now we could just go through that and do the same in each one of the others. So let's put in some other duplicates just so we can see it working. So let's have a duplicate telephone call. So let's put that into there. And let's have a duplicate work item. Put that on the end there. And once again, when we run that, we'll see that we're getting too many objects, 13 of them now. So essentially, it's just going to be cut and paste. So that's now going to need to be a communication item. And that just needs to have hours on there. The other code is exactly the same, so we could actually isolate that into one place, but I won't bother for now. And then same again on our work item, and so that one becomes a work item, which also needs estimated hours. And so now that should just work in exactly the same way, except we're back down to 11. So that's the flyweight pattern. for saving memory if you've got a lot of duplicate items in a complex hierarchy, like a composite, but others as well. Obviously, as with anything like this, which is really a performance issue, trying to save memory, not trying to change the functionality, you've got to work out for yourself, probably with experimentation, whether the trade-offs are worthwhile. But if you want to, Flyweight Pattern is a really neat way of saving duplication. So, those three patterns we've seen side by side, the composite, the vidstat, and the flyweight. Hope you enjoyed that. If you want to know about any more patterns, do put a comment in the comment section below. Do like it, do subscribe, and I'll see you next time on something else.